This summer, Lauren Bacall was replaced by Raquel Welch in the star role in the Broadway play Woman of the Year. There's nothing unusual about that, one star following another in a long-run play. But for Raquel Welch, the part represents a kind of fulfillment, a vindication of her insistence that she is capable of something better and more demanding than the sex symbol roles that she's played for the past 18 years in Hollywood. Well, here with the story of Raquel Welch's struggle to be taken seriously is Bob Brown. Bob?
You Americans have always been infatuated by sex symbols, but Raquel Welch has complained for years about the problems created by her image. Well, earlier this summer, Raquel, who'll be 42 next month, was working hard in a New York City rehearsal room on a different kind of image as a Broadway leading lady in Woman of the Year.
Hey, adjust. That was the adjustment. You adjusted beautifully.
It's been a long transition for the star of films like 1 Million Years B.C., Kansas City Bomber, and Mother Jugs and Speed, from Hollywood's reigning sex symbol to a performer who seemed right at home in a chorus line. When she finally took the stage in the show, she got the best reviews of her career in a place where there were no retakes. Work she's put into the show, the benefits aren't bad either. She's earning around $90,000 a month, and she's overcome some of the disadvantages of being viewed as a sex symbol.
I always thought that this was a pretty nice thing, being a sex symbol. I always thought that it was meant to be something kind of terrific. I just was not aware of quite what went with the territory as far as the downside of it, you know, the skepticism of other people and the fact that they could try to make a joke out of you and things and make sort of cruel asides and try to diminish whatever else it was that you did.
The people who jam the sidewalks outside Raquel's stage door each night, where she makes the short walk to a limousine hidden behind a curtain of fans, represent the intense curiosity that's also part of the territory.
Thank you for smiling at me.
They wonder what you'll be like in real life. Will you be as good looking? Will your voice sound the same? Will you be able to really be charming and exciting as you are? They wonder if you can live up to it.
All the onlookers who got a glimpse of Raquel at this party following her Broadway opening found that she is a little smaller than most of her film roles have made her appear. She stands around 5'6" tall, but she says she never weighs herself or takes her measurements because the figures can change and they don't mean much aesthetically. There have been thousands of others with similar sizes and shapes who haven't lasted as long or protected themselves as well as Raquel Welch. When Raquel Welch became a star, and she was to soldiers in the Vietnam era what Betty Grable and Rita Hayworth were to GIs in World War II, it happened not only as a result of well-staged publicity campaigns, but also because of her own single-mindedness about the career she wanted.
Raquel Welch, a girl from La Jolla, California, loves life.
She was in her early 20s, already the holder of such California beauty titles as Miss Contour when she began to pursue her ambition. In part, her instincts for separating what was necessary for her career from what wasn't came after her teenage marriage to her first husband, James Welch, had broken up, and she was on her own, caring for two young children.
I was part of a group of young actresses that were all trying and all wanted to get a chance. And it seemed like some of them were being ruthless with themselves. They would do anything to get there. But they didn't see the difference between the real work and the theater around the edges and the people who would sort of always hand you a line and say, hey, you know, I can get you. that sort of thing. And I always felt that my children gave me a kind of protective attitude toward myself. I don't think that women see children as a support of themselves, which they are. They give you a sense of yourself and a kind of respect for yourself and a kind of dignity, in a sense, about how you go about things, because you are their mother.
You know, Raquel here is our billboard girl. Now, isn't she gorgeous?
She got one of her first breaks on television's Hollywood Palace.
You go to my dressing room. I'll stay here. I need the rest.
The jokes that would dog her image as a sex symbol were just beginning. The process of selling her as a sex symbol didn't really begin in Hollywood, however. It began in Europe, aided by a hard-working press agent named Patrick Curtis, who eventually became Raquel's second husband. Curtis helped bring Raquel to the attention of the droves of European newspaper and magazine photographers when she was filming a movie titled 1 Million Years B.C. All that publicity rebounded to the United States, where Europe's newest sex symbol became America's newest sex symbol. But Raquel found there was a difference between the attention she received in Europe and the skepticism that was mixed with adulation here.
It was because of a strange kind of uncomfortable attitude that a lot of people have, I think, more in this country, with sensuality and sex, period. They just feel embarrassed by it. They like it a lot, but they're somehow embarrassed by the admission of it. This period of time in the history of women in this country has bred a kind of, I think, terror of the female sex. And I think that's isolated us. And I certainly feel, as an actress and as a mother and as a sex symbol and whatever else, as a businesswoman, or that people are intimidated by women.
Look up there. Don't we make a pretty pair?
Yes.
Despite her feelings about her image, she took advantage of it, playing roles she would later criticize in films that got good box office and bad reviews. Bedazzled, in which she played a character named Lillian Lust, was one of the few that was well received as a film.
Hot toast or buttered buns?
Either.
Oh, I love a man who knows what he wants. Do you crave...
If she was ambivalent about doing work she called camp while wanting to be taken seriously, she was also getting a reputation for being mistrustful of directors and co-stars, who in turn found her temperamental and difficult to work with.
There was a director who was quoted as saying, "You have a chip on your shoulder when you arrive at work because you're afraid you're going to get shafted."
When it starts out, I always think it's going to be terrific. And then maybe the disillusionment starts setting in at different junctures along the way. I would sort of be alive with enthusiasm and come up to the director and talk about the scene and what I had planned, and was I on the same track as he was, and what all about the motivations of the character and kind of things that I felt about something. And they would just look at me like I was crazy. They'd say, "Oh," roll their eyes to heaven. It's like, "Oh, she wants to be an actress, you know." And I was always kind of insulted about it, I must tell you. I always thought, I mean, if that's what you meant by a chip on the shoulder, yeah, I was insulted about it. Yeah, I have enough personal pride to say, "Hey, wait a minute. You think this is easy? You try it. You put on the little loinskin bikini and be out here and see if you can make this thing look like anything. It might look simple, but it's not that, not what you think."
She is, after all, only a woman.
She got good notices for playing a comic character who was mainly accident-prone in a version of The Three Musketeers, and in a sequel called The Four Musketeers. For that role, she won a Golden Globe Award.
I'm awful happy. I guess you can see that. But I've been waiting for this one since 1 million years BC.
But as she approached the age of 40, she still wasn't being offered the types of film roles she thought she deserved, until in 1980, she was hired to play a dramatic role in a film based on John Steinbeck's novel, Cannery Row.
To be able to play a heroine that was a John Steinbeck heroine with a lot of colors and things was, for me, a wonderful chance to do a definitive role on film. And when it didn't happen, it hurt very much.
What hurt was that she was fired from the project in a contract dispute. Raquel fired back by suing the studio involved MGM for $25 million. But it was an emotional and professional blow at a time when she needed to broaden her options as an actress. That's when an unexpected opportunity came along, an opportunity with some risk attached. What she did was accept an offer to appear in the New York theater, first as a two-week vacation replacement for Lauren Bacall in Woman of the Year, then as Bacall's permanent replacement.
Want me to take it?
I think you should take it.
Was right.
That's right.
I was perfectly right.
Right.
My instincts were valid and strong.
That's right.
The creators of the show, songwriters Fred Ebb and John Kander, and scriptwriter Peter Stone, had written a plot around a celebrity television personality who tries to work out the conflicts between her love life and her job.
I knew I had to go to New York and Larry would be hammering editing newspaper in Colorado somewhere and it's time for a break. I had
Kander and Ebb even gave Raquel a song to introduce into the show, a ballad called Who Would Have Dreamed, helping her work on the shadings in her interpretation.
He's just real easy.
Perfect as it seems.
Little girl.
Who would have ever
dreamed? Raquel once joked that it took more guts than brains to try the Broadway show. But when it all comes down to her work, she has a reserve of confidence and discipline, reinforced by the strenuous yoga exercises she practices each day, shutting off the rest of the world, keeping herself in shape.
You want to go pretend like applause, applause here?
Okay.
And applause, applause, applause.
And if, when she was younger, her work made her a kind of unwilling straight woman for other people's jokes, she can afford to play it for laughs now.
That's wonderful.
What's so wonderful?
In rehearsals, Raquel paid careful attention to comic expressions and timing in a duet with Broadway veteran Marilyn Cooper.
What's so wonderful? You can hold a husband. That's wonderful. Be sensitive to what's going on there, David. You're just running along, you know. That's a heavy line there. Okay?
Okay.
All right, just beware. Okay. Wait a minute, we better do that again. That was a real train wreck there.
The song is the show-stopping number in Woman of the Year, called The Grass is Always Greener, about the contrast in lifestyles between a homemaker and the superstar played by Raquel. And the irony behind the lyrics is never lost on the audience.
There was something about just being there in flesh and blood with the audience there, and I suddenly realized that people were not out to get me.
And when the number was over on opening night, Raquel got to hear a request you hardly ever hear on a movie set. Someone in the audience yelled for more.
Jeff! Wish we had.
As much as she dislikes the idea of habitually having to prove herself, what the New York Theater District became for Raquel was another proving ground, far different from the one she first learned to deal with. The children, who helped give her a protective attitude about herself when she was starting out, are both grown now. Her son Damon is 22, and her daughter Tawny is 20. She is developing other film projects with her husband Andre. But she seems happy with the fact that working on the stage has finally provided a different focus on her career and made the years of transition more graceful than they might have been.
Really, to you guys. We're having a lot of fun out there, okay? Let's have a good time.
We leave the door of the dressing room.
I don't want to go. my bugle beaded dress either, you know. I don't want to be one of those diehards, you know, where they keep turning up to have a look at you and see if you're still stuck together all right. And so, yes, the fact that I could deliver in an area where nobody knew I could made me the winner. I just felt great. I'd made it. Isn't that funny?
Thank you, Bob. We will be right back.
For a Hollywood sex symbol at the height of her beauty and youth, there's only one place to go: down. She gets older, the roles get fewer and farther between, but you're about to meet a woman who's lived through that fear and come out the other side. She's Raquel Welch, and coming up to 61. It's clear her past will not limit her future. She's ready for the world. Is the world ready for Raquel?
Introducing the fabulous Raquel Welch.
39, 22, 33, Welch.
Now, I know I was a nice little piece of TNA. I know that going in. But there's millions of, you know, good-looking girls with nice racks, you know, in this planet. And they didn't do anything with it.
Would you help me with my buttons? I seem to be all thumbs this morning.
No matter how Raquel Welch approached it, she inherited an image without much of a long-term future, but which this summer has enjoyed still another renaissance. In her early 20s, she was the most visible and highly promoted sex symbol in Hollywood, under contract to 20th Century Fox, the same studio that had groomed her predecessor, Marilyn Monroe. When she reached her 40s, the number of film roles predictably declined, and she turned to Broadway to breathe life into her career. I met her for the first time then, nearly 20 years and one bygone image ago, for me. Now in her 60s, Raquel Welch can still fit the image she both created and fought. And her 61st birthday, September 5th, is less than a month away.
The morning of September 5th, you'll turn on the radio, you'll hear a disc jockey read Happy...
You know, what is it about... In the United States, there's nothing that is more gleeful and exciting than an aging sex symbol having another birthday. You know, what is wrong with being an adult woman? I mean, I think that this is a great thing. I think it's a fun thing. I've already done the other thing. Doesn't hold a lot of real interest for me.
Born Raquel Tejada, of a Bolivian father and an American mother, her Latino background is something she suppressed early in her career for fear of being even more stereotyped as a bombshell. Now, it's one of the reasons she is so visible this summer.
For some reason, I've never been able to find the right man.
She plays a widow seeking a husband in a new movie called Tortilla Soup.
In the middle of making love, he had a heart attack and died.
I'm so sorry.
Just like that.
I'm sorry.
And your wife?
She's also featured as a Latino mother in the PBS series An American Family.
I'm going to be a single mother.
A single mother? What, no husband, no father? I mean, my daughter? A single mother?
And she does a comic turn in the summer hit Legally Blonde.
Well, she was sitting next to the pool, topless, while the Latin boy handed her a drink.
Raquel!
Raquel!
But that all came after she crossed a long bridge, a sex symbol who still commanded attention as she grew older. Her name is among the first three on a Playboy list of the sexiest women of the 20th century. But unlike the other two names at the top, Marilyn Monroe, who died at 36, and Jane Mansfield, who died at 34, Raquel Welch has survived to reflect on how and why her image developed and what she did to make it different. Most famously, her breakout came from a 1966 movie called 1 Million Years B.C., when she posed as a cave girl for what became the biggest selling poster up to its time. As someone said, the reason man walks upright.
Why that image, and why you?
That one image of me, with the arms sort of akimbo and the legs spread apart, that's not a pinup girl that you saw any time before that. And I didn't want to just be a schlub in a doe-skin bikini. And that photograph sort of caught the essence of that rather formidable new woman. Of course, I had a lot of time to think about it. And then I thought, oh, well, but look what came before. I mean, Marilyn Monroe was, you know, and I was, hey, I'm ready for you. You ready for me? It was like I opened the forbidden door. It's a very scary thing to be a sex symbol just to begin with. It's just scary. It sort of obliterates everything else. And I was always fighting in that. I was just struggling to get out. You know, this is part of the reason why sometimes I had tempestuous relationships in certain professional situations, because I wanted out.
When she fought for better roles, she got a reputation for being difficult. Her career stalled after she crossed the age of 40 and was removed from the film Cannery Row.
One, two, three, four, tie.
With her film career in jeopardy, she took a job in 1982 that some thought she could never fill, as a replacement for Lauren Bacall in the musical Woman of the Year. It was a tough Broadway world where there were no retakes, but she astounded critics and got uniformly good reviews for her performance.
And the curtain came up, and I couldn't believe it. Do this.
Well, that still affects you emotionally, just to think about, because of the time.
Sure. Yeah, sorry. Sorry.
Was it because of the time in your life that it came, or?
You know, I don't know if I can analyze this one, especially right now when I'm kind of emotionally charged up. I don't think that I ever realized in my life, because I hadn't been enough in front of live audiences, I didn't know that the audience out there, not the industry, but the audience out there, they liked what I did. You know, I sound like Sally Fields now, oh geez. But I mean, they were ready, they were receptive. I didn't sing a note. They were up. And I said, oh. So everything that I did, everything that I did up to this point was not just garbage. Somehow I got through to people.
She is now in her fourth marriage to Richie Palmer, who she met at a friend's birthday party. He's an entrepreneur who owns a chain of pizza parlors, which she helps promote, and he is 14 years younger than she is. Palmer was still a kid when that image-setting poster of Raquel first came out in the 1960s.
Did you ever think about the difference in your ages?
You know, I didn't until I found out how old he was. I didn't realize he was that much younger than I was. I really didn't want to get married again, and that's why it was shocking for him to ask me, because I thought, you know, I've never gotten this right. I never got the marriage thing right. But I looked at it and I thought, you know, if you say yes, that means you're really going to have to work at it. You're not going to be able to throw in the towel, and you're not going to, and it's going to be uncomfortable. You know it is.
So Maxine's going to work on the stuff that, like, changes the way you actually look.
Welch's relationship with the female audience has also changed as she got older. She is perceived as less of a threat, more of an example. She's about to launch a line of high-end skincare products under her name and with her face, clearly one of the selling points. She also has a line of wigs she has marketed for several years. In a way, she has arrived somewhere on the other side of an image in which what she represented was expected to be both flawless and disposable. And the future was less frightening than she thought.
If you were sitting alone in a room with someone like Marilyn Monroe, just the two of you, what do you think you would talk about with her?
First of all, of course, we check each other out. And I like to ask her what was going on and if she really wanted to make that transition. That transition you have to make from being the young beauty, the sex symbol of the moment, that transition you have to make to go to the next stage. I don't think she wanted to go there because I've crossed the bridge. And you know what? The anticipation of crossing that bridge was so, so devastatingly scary. It's much, much worse than just crossing. Just taking the step and saying, I don't know if I'm going to get across this, but I am going to take these steps, damn it. And I'm going to see what's on the other side. The doing of it was much, much easier than the thinking about how it was going to be.
You go, girl.